For the rest of the trip, we'll be exploring the Cyclades. This group of over 200 islands form a circle around the sacred island of Delos. The islands are the peaks of submerged mountains, except for the volcanic islands of Milos and Santorini. We're flying from Athens to Paros in the center of the Cyclades. Our Olympic Airlines de Havilland Dash 8 delivers us safely to Paros Airport. Paros is roughly round, measuring 13 miles by 10 miles. The island is the top of a mountain of marble, about 2,400 feet above sea level. We check into the Area Boutique Hotel. Area was one of the many names given to the island over the years. We settle into our spacious villa. We have a little downtime on our bougainvillea-covered patio. I try out the plunge pool and quickly discover that it's unheated. It's soon time to try out the Nefeli restaurant with a menu created by a Michelin-starred chef. We have an easy day today. After a late breakfast, we head to the beach. We're at the end of the tourist season, and there are just a few people on the beach. The hammocks are tempting, but we opt to go back to our resort. The resort's pool is almost empty too. But the bar is open, and we enjoy some liquid refreshment by the pool. Then we get to know some of the locals. In the late afternoon, we head for Piso Livadi for a cooking lesson. It's a small fishing village on the east coast of Paros. Today it caters more to tourists than fishermen. Our cooking lesson is on board a traditional fishing boat. As we head out of the harbor, we meet our chef, Maria, who will introduce us to the cuisine of the Cyclades. At anchor in the harbor, Maria starts her prep. The first course is fried feta, rolled in sesame seeds and topped with Paros honey, enjoyed with homemade salma, like Italian grappa, only better. The next course is shrimp in tomato sauce with feta, onion, green pepper, and garlic. The second appetizer is roasted eggplant salad with parsley and red pepper. Next up is a salad with a difference. It's a delicious toss of lettuce, peaches, carrots, and zucchini with a honey mustard dressing. The main course is roast octopus in tomato sauce. Delicious. The food was outstanding, but the best part of the meal was Chef Maria talking about her island life. From the 6th century BC, Paros grew rich from its marble quarries. Some of the greatest masterpieces of ancient Greek sculpture were carved from Parian marble. This marble is fine-grained, semi-transparent, pure white, and entirely flawless. We're headed to Lefkes, a small village of about 500 people. Our guide, Cappy, leads us through the winding streets and introduces us to Cycladic residential architecture. The whitewashed cube homes are built next to and on top of each other. The narrow streets are paved in stone with painted grout and meander through the town. Shadows, windows, and doors are painted Aegean blue. Bougainvillea and other plants stand out against the whitewashed exteriors. The town was once an exclusively agricultural community. This old windmill was used to grind the grain. But today it's a tourist destination and artist colony. We make a brief stop in Ampelis to admire the beach. Our next stop is Noaussa, which sits on one of the best harbors on the island. There's still an active fishing fleet based here. This is all that's left of a fortress built in the 15th century by the Venetians to protect the harbor from pirates. The small beach is lined with restaurants, small hotels, and shops. The Church of the Assumption of the Virgin looks over the tourist bars from the highest point in Noaussa. Kulumbi Thresh Beach is one of the most popular beaches in Paros. It's located on the bay of Noaussa. It's unique because of the huge blocks of weathered granite that line the shore. The name means swimming pools because of the many small sandy coves between the boulders. Our next stop is the capital of Paros, Parikia. It's a major hub for the Greek ferry system. Not to be missed is the Panagia Ekatanta Filiani, the church with 100 doors. The source of the name is obscure, but it has never had 100 doors. The church dates back to 326 AD. Legend has it that it was founded by the mother of Roman Emperor Constantine. This icon of the Virgin Mary is believed to have miracle-working powers. It's paraded through the streets every August 15th. The church was severely damaged in an earthquake in the 18th century, but has been beautifully restored over the years. And now from the sacred to the profane, we're back into the streets. The narrow streets of Parikia offer great examples of Cycladic architecture. But when you least expect it, there's a piece of history. In 1777, Nicholas Marvoginus was serving as the Ottoman governor of Wallachia. He missed his birthplace so much that he gifted Parikia with three of these fountains. Down another street is the Frankish castle, built in the 1200s by the Venetians from materials scavenged from ancient temples all over the island. The Church of St. Constantine sits on a cliff overlooking the Aegean. A passing ferry reminds us that tomorrow we leave for Naxos. But before that, we have another island to explore, Antiparos. It's just 1 nautical mile and a 15-minute ferry ride away from Paros. In the heart of Antiparos town is the castro, or castle. It was built in 1440 by Venetians to encourage settlers to the island. It's an example of fortified settlements that were built in the Cyclades from the 13th to the 16th century. This is what remains of the castle keep. A water source for the castle was critical. On the way back to the ferry, we pass many closed restaurants and shops. This is the end of the tourist season, and the owners will leave their shops and restaurants to the cats until next May. We catch our ferry back to Paros, then back to the Iria Hotel. It's been a long, busy day. We wrap up our stay on Paros with another outstanding dinner at the Nefeli restaurant.